Okay, so now we are live. Welcome to our first live stream from Startup Grind Bucharest. Today from Mindspace Business District, the Center of Innovation in Bucharest, where we are also holding each event on our series. Today we'll have a coffee and a glass of water with Bogdan Axinia, Managing Director from eMAG Ventures. Thank you for coming and accepting
our
invitation. We also have, as I think you already know, Mircea Moraru, our colleagues from CMS. CMS is our global partner, and also in 2021, after a full year of pandemic, CMS is also with us, sustaining all the entrepreneurial realm and all our activities here in Bucharest. Thank you very much, Mircea, for being here.
Thanks for inviting me.
Today we will have a great subject because we are talking about corporate venture capital funds, a part of the venture capital family, and we'll try to discover what's behind this the definition of corporate venture capital, and what it's doing and how it differs from the other VCs that we have also here and in Central and Eastern Europe. I will ask by presenting some data about corporate VCs worldwide and in Europe. Mircea Moraru also will clarify some legal aspects now about the corporate VCs, and maybe some parallel with the merger and acquisition world, because we are talking about a corporation that's behind some investment. And after that, of course, we'll have some discussion with Bogdan on the subject to understand what are the motives behind creating this investment vehicle for EMAG. So I will start by talking a little bit about the corporate VCs, and thank you very much for sending me some really interesting articles on the subject from PitchBook and also from Mind the Bridge. I will quote from some really interesting reports covering the corporate VCs area, and we'll talk about the corporate VCs after the financial crisis from 2008. So we will analyze it a little bit, the evolution of this area between 2010, 2020, and see how this trend continues or have been transformed during the pandemic. So after the global financial recession, we see that a lot of corporates invested in this, in these new vehicles to try to access the innovation agility of startups in order to invest in, acquire new technologies in this area. New technologies that have been born after the financial crisis, because as we already say, but in this case it's also true, any crisis comes with great opportunities. Some of the economic actors are dying, new ones are born, so corporates wanted to be maybe in this area. And we see that between 2010 and 2020, we have grown three times the number of corporate VCs in this 10-year period. And if we talk about, ratios in US, CVCs, corporate VCs, have been present in somewhere around 25% of the overall investment deals. But if we are talking about the value invested, we reach almost 50-60% in some cases. So they do invest alone, but also in, it's interesting, co-investing with other financial VCs, which is quite a very interesting trend. About that, also in Europe, we see somehow the same trend. So it is an area of the VC that is growing, interestingly. As from the point of view of the recipient of the investment, if we are talking about the level of development of these startups, we see that they are interested in the revenue pre-profit stage, and now in the last years also in the early stage phase of a startup. motivated by the interested not to gain, let's say, immediate profitability, but to have access, early access in their technology. And this is something that we would like to discuss with you also after that. If we are talking about the origin of corporate VCs, now we are talking in America, we see that the majority are originated from US, but then as foreign investment, we see Japan on the first place. Until 2 years ago, Japan was on the same level with China, but of course due to the last development in the US-China relationship, we see that China is retiring from the US market, also in this area. But Japan is followed closely by UK, Germany, and South Korea corporates that are interested to establish CVCs in this area. And of course, if it is to talk about some great companies after 2010 that created these CVCs, we can talk about Google CVC arm, Salesforce Ventures, Bloomberg Beta, M12 from Microsoft, and Dell Technology Capital. So this is just an overview about the subject that we are talking today. And I will ask first to ask Mircea, what can you say? It is the CVC and investment from corporate VCs a fast track to a further merger and acquisition, or do you think it's only profitability? What is your view on the CVC, and especially having the experience of CMS in these deals?
Well, it's always curious thing to start talking about. I think it's a lot up to what people are actually seeking in an investment. And usually, yes, they go for profit. Usually, if they can get short-term profit, they will. But normally, their plan is to hang around a bit more than a normal venture capital fund. They would be interested to help growing the business and help be engaged in development, in management, in finance, or to implement a lot more things than a venture capital would do. And as in any kind of investment, it's key for everyone to understand what the other party is about. And your point is quite helpful also for the startups who are maybe watching this, this series, because it's, when they start a deal with a CVC, they should expect a bit of a different animal from a venture capital. So it's key to understand the party's position and to see how they see the development, because obviously a deal does not finish when completion is made, when when you get a new partner. A deal finishes when the investment goes it reaches expectations and goes beyond that. So if people think, hopefully they won't, if people think that you sign, you complete, you close, and that's it, then maybe they are mistaken. They should see a corporate VC for what it is. It's an entity wanting to generate profits, obviously, wanting to get something from the investment, but that moment is a bit further down the road. And you're looking at a partnership, you need to have chemistry with them, you need to get to trust people, you need them to trust you. And that's what we see is a bit of a challenge, not necessarily on the local market, but generally in the startup community, because I think there's a bit of a disconnect between the expectations of the parties. People are not always educated to understand how things should look like. They need a bit of help to prepare for this moment, which is almost traumatic. And if they don't have someone to guide, to hold their hand, as we say it, let's say unconventionally, and to explain them how things are done, and not only how but why, that's when things may go bust, either during the transactional phase or afterwards, which is a lot worse, because you can really damage a good product, a good team, a good business by not thinking about the integration phase and the moment when you actually get to get the benefits, yeah, to create value for everyone involved. Especially since, well, the CVC is not going to hang around forever. they may want to, it's very likely they want to exit, or they want to be alone in the investment. So to take over the partnership altogether, and that's something that people are not always willing to see in the beginning of the process. So it's such an interesting animal, let's say, CVC.
Really, really interesting. I will come back to what you said, that between the VC and the startup there should be chemistry. And now coming to you, Bogdan, looking on your LinkedIn profile, you had a lot of professional position on the tech, in tech companies, in the tech areas. You are also graduated by Stanford University in innovation. So we'll say that you are the right guy for this position. What is the place of chemistry between eMAG and a startup?
Yeah, very, very good, very good points. Indeed, there is need to build trust, it's one of the criteria when we look as an investment. eMAG has done some investment in the past, and we formalize this kind of investment, creating a program as eMAG Ventures, because we see the value that we create when we put a good team with a good product and potential to grow right besides our know-how and of course capital. So I would say that it's a must to be chemistry between the founders and the people who interact with them from the VC. And I think for the companies that really took off in where we invested, this was one of the key elements, because we had some entrepreneur who was right behind us, and they are still together with us, and we could build this relation. Yeah. And it's something that comes along. Yeah, that is this part where we have the negotiation, and it could be traumatic, but you have to be careful not to break bridges in that period, because afterwards you'll work together, and so we are working closely with the companies that we invest.
And now about the trauma, of course, this is the duty of a lawyer when presenting a case or a situation, to put what can happen really bad in a transaction. This is how they already, when they say, after they say hello, this is how bad it might go. And after that, of course, if you work with us, everything will be okay, but it is true. Also, we have a very interesting book from Mircea Moraru that my colleagues from Startup Grind will post on the comment chat, on the comment section. It's about the deals that might not happen and how to avoid this.
The worst thing is when a deal happens and it's a failure in the end.
Ah.
That's the worst thing that can happen. Just to be honest, I can negotiate the deal, I can help it sign, but then it's out of my hands. Yeah, so
very responsible. I really like Mircea for being straightforward, but this is true. We need really good professionals. Tell me about the portfolio of the startup that eMAG already invested in.
Yeah, well, we had a wide range of investment. Mostly, in a way or another, related to our core e-commerce business. Some of them were spin-off from eMAG at the beginning. We have Conversion and Depanero, who are departments in eMAG, and we decided to do spin-off in order to grow faster and address other market. And afterwards, we started to invest it in or make joint ventures with companies strictly in e-commerce. And it was the case in Hungary, where we made a joint venture with Extreme Digital, and in Romania we invested in PC Garage. Afterwards, we start to expand from the core business. It was same day, and Eu Ce Mănânc now as does. First one is logistics, second one is food delivery. Actually, in the last deal I was pretty close with those two companies, and they really scale up fast. As an example, same day had 4 years ago 2,000 deliveries per day. Now they are close to 200,000 per day. So it's
really
it's a really scale up. And in the same case, TAS has a 10x scale from February last year in terms
so
of
in full pandemic.
Yeah, in full pandemic. Luckily, we were on the right side of the of the business in the pandemics. This is also true, but we were prepared for that because it's in eMAG DNA to be prepared with this fast scale up. So I was close to these two business and we helped them scale up. It's something that we know, but we know in some condition. It has to be tech beside, and that's why I'm here, because my background is in tech, and I've been with eMAG since we are 500, now we are 5,000 plus people. So I've been in this phase where the company scale up fast, and that's something that we could help businesses.
So Bogdan, you personally also enter in their board or in their management?
Yeah,
in their board.
Yeah, I was close to them as in daily, weekly meetings on different topics. On different topics. It's of course it takes two to tango. So it was something they also wanted and appreciated. It's not something that we impose. Yeah, if there is that chemistry and alignment after some initial dance, things that really could go well. But it's important that this chemistry and understanding of the motivation behind for each part is to be there. And afterwards, I think it's of great value.
Very interesting. I would like to come back with something that you said. It's let's say I wasn't expecting this timeline. You said that some of the startups that you invested in actually have been spin-offs from eMAG in the first place. So some of your departments, just went out on their own. And what's in this case, where does eMAG Venture intervene in the spin-off?
It was the case many years ago. But again, it could be right beside them. In help them in this part of or scale up or create value by on different topics, but it's also true that the plans that we have with Depanero didn't manage to happen, and it was something that we are prepared to take. It's possible that there are some investment that will scale up, some other will not, because of the in the Panelo case it was about market condition. We want to put a plan for a repair in every household in Romania, but we discover soon enough that we don't have the supply part. We don't have enough skilled people that could do that, and something you it's possible to discover on doing. The panel is doing well, but it's not the way that we wanted. Let's say 10 years ago when we started, it's something that it could happen, and we are prepared also to see this case.
Tell me now to go more in details and talking about eMAG Venture. Tell me also for our audience, if you have any selected industries that you that your strategy will invest in, first of all, and then also regarding the development level of these startups. When do you usually invest in, if you have such a strategy?
As I told you, we want to put, beside capital, we want to put our know-how. And our know-how is in B2C, B2B2C businesses. Is something that we know to do, how to create engagement and this kind of businesses, how to scale, and this is one of the criteria. Another criteria, it's related to technology. It has to be backed by technology, because we need that, we think that technology is needed in order to scale fast. After then, we look at companies that again could create that are on verticals that could create bigger value having eMAG right beside. And right now we are looking in vertical like fintech, health, and also in the green and sustainability part. But also, as you mentioned in the beginning, companies that could have great technology that could be tested on e-commerce or logistic on food delivery. Yeah? We are open to that. And we are looking companies that are, let's say, at the revenue phase. Yeah?
At the revenue phase.
Yeah.
Okay. Really interesting. And if we are talking about the value investment, do you have standardized this? Do you know exactly, or it's up to each case?
It's up to each case. What we did in the past, and what is our playbook? It's not only our playbook in eMAG. We also have a big investor, strategic investor in eMAG, which is Nasports. Is the one of the biggest investor in internet and media company, the biggest African company, which also invested in Tencent in China. But that playbook is to invest in companies where they keep the entrepreneurs, the founders, and the executive team, and they have to have skin in the game. And after they and after we understand the model and the way of working with this the team, sky is the limit in terms of investment. Yeah. So we had also in Taz in same day, let's say a smaller investment. And afterwards, we were prepared and invested tens of millions in growing the tens of millions of euro in growing the company. So we start with smaller investments, and afterward, we don't have a problem investing in a company which has good foundation in order to scale and also to have a plan to go to profit in.
Related to the percentage of the share that you will own in these companies, are you a minority one?
We are looking
for majority.
We are open both on both parts, on minority and majority. There are cases where we want to have a majority, but we are also open and will invest in minority investment, where we will sit besides. But again, I must tell you that we must feel that we'll bring value besides capital, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
being there, and has to be something quite interesting for us.
So let's take from here and think about, after you invested, this is profitable, what are the next stages? What is the follow-up? Do you want to acquire it? Do you want to sell it? if you have this in mind, some scenarios
as Mircea said, we are a different animal. CVC, it's a different animal, and eMAG, it's again a different animal in CVC world. We are looking for the long term. We don't have plan to exit this market. The only plan that it's possible to have is to have an IPO for eMAG, and the same way we are thinking for the company that we invest. In the ideal world, there will be an IPO or maybe greater integration with eMAG if it's the case. But it's important that each business we are looking right now, that each business has value in itself, yeah? And that's the way that we are looking at investment. We are looking and see and try to do a evaluation of the investment as a business itself.
Mircea, because we talked about these following stages of development, if you are talking about an IPO for a company that is settled in Romania, which eMAG invested, where do you think would be the best market to have the IPO? In Romania, in Central Eastern Europe, maybe abroad? What is your experience on this area?
Well, until recently there was a debate between UK and US.
Yeah.
And then within UK and US you can choose multiple markets where you want to list. Recently, continental Europe is picking up speed as compared to to UK. Amsterdam, maybe Frankfurt. The liquidity there is quite good. They're still within the EU.
Yeah.
For the US, there's if you don't have you need to have a connection with the US to understand the market, to be able to list, to be known to investors and so on. You can obviously go and do a listing and so on. But let's say that the first area that people explore is not Romania, because there's not a lot of liquidity here, especially for tech companies, maybe not even the region. I don't think you would go to Warsaw. I think you would go westwards where the larger market is. You would go to, again, Frankfurt, Amsterdam, UK still, maybe London. And then when you're big enough, you can think about the US. But it depends a lot on the moment when you want to list, when you want to be floating. Depends on who's investing, because most likely if you have an US investor, they would be more close to that market to want to float there. So it's not, I don't have an answer back, but I see that it's less UK, more continental Europe. US is always interesting because there's a lot of money there. Asia is not very common for European entities, at least not in the first phase.
Okay. Great. So we'll see. We are expecting the first IPO for one of your companies in your portfolio.
Yeah.
Until then, because we are coming to an end, we have another 5 minutes to have some questions from the audience. I have to tell that we have six startups here in the audience. Everyone keeping the social distancing between them. So for the last 5 minutes, if you have any question for Bogdan, please, you can ask them.
Hi,
Bogdan,
I'm Bogdan from NutriCare Life. And I want to ask you, Bogdan, which are the two main criteria who are taken in consideration when you evaluate a startup?
Yeah. Two, it's a little bit now, but I think it's very important, and I personally look at the team and the product, and afterwards I look at the market and what the market they adjust, but I would start with the team and the product. It's something that I believe. I also read the book, and I recommend the book, The Hard Things About Hard Things. I think it's in the comment section.
Yes, my comment.
And the Ben Horowitz, which created a great startup, and afterwards is one of the hottest VC in the tech area, said that as an entrepreneur, you should focus on the team product, and the sales will come. I also believe that.
Thank you very much. Another question from you guys. Diana from Easy Dog, please.
So you said that you have an interest in B2B2C type of businesses. Is this because you can make use of your existing network, existing, let's say, client base? How do you evaluate this part?
Yes, it's mostly because we have experience in that part. We have built the eMAG marketplace. I came in eMAG 9 years ago in order to build the eMAG marketplace. There were three sellers then. Now there are over 40,000 sellers in all the countries. So we have a little bit of experience on how to build that and how to understand the needs of each party involved in a marketplace, because there are a lot of stakeholders at the table, and also we build that in TAS. So we have some experience that here, and we could help with that experience. It's part of the value that we said that we bring to the table.
Thank you very much, Diana. If okay, Alin Roșca, please.
I'm Alin Roșca from RepSmate. I would like to ask Bogdan if you can define some ranges for early stage startups, because it's a bit unclear for me.
Some what?
Some ranges. What exactly? How exactly would you define early stage startups?
Early stage with interest for us.
Yeah.
I said that we are looking mostly at companies that have some revenues.
So what exactly?
We don't have a figures here, but I see interesting startup which has a few clients, but there is path to grow. So it's a proven model, and the clients are willing to pay. So we don't have a barrier on that. But it's important that for us at this stage, in this moment of eMAG Ventures, to have some history behind, and to have at least some paying customers. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much, guys. So we arrive at the end of this fireside chat. Thank you for having you guys here. Tell me if someone in the audience would like to contact you. Should they use LinkedIn? Should they use email?
LinkedIn.
Okay. So my colleagues will put also. You'll have the LinkedIn address from Bogdan Axinia, Managing Director eMAG Ventures, Mircea Moraru, M&A Senior Associate at CMS Law. Thank you very much for being here, and hopefully we'll see you next time. So thank you, and goodbye.